Okay, well, thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here. So, I mean, I don't know, I've never met Arthur August before today, but as it will be clear, I mean, I have used a lot of things and I'm going to talk about some results that he really pioneered, I guess. Okay, so my goal is to talk about the K3 case for two, well, big conjectures, which are the following. So I want to. So there is a Tate conjecture for surfaces. So let K be. Okay, so I'm going to talk about positive characteristic. Let K be a finite field. I mean, you can enlarge the setting if you want. Let X be a smooth projective, let's say, surface over K. Well, the Tate conjecture, then you have a cycle class map from the Picard group of X with ZL coefficients. Onto etal cohomology, so maybe let me put it that way. So onto the Galois invariant of etal cohomology, so here L is a prime number different from the characteristic of the base field. Then this should be an isomorphism. Okay, and the other, so I'm going to talk about two things, and I'll explain why I have one talk for these. And the other thing, which is more specific, which applies to a smaller set of surfaces, which is due to Shioda. Here maybe K, so K is something like, well, let's say K is the algebraic K is a field of characteristic P. This is a geometric conjecture, so let's take an algebraically closed field. Let X over K be a smooth projective surface over K. So with the two following conditions, so I want X to be simply connected, so algebraically simply connected, so there is no etal, finite etal cover of X, and I want the rank of the Néron-Sévry group of X, or of the Picard group of X, if you wish. I want this to be equal to, well, let's say B2, so the rank of H2, X, K bar ZL of 1. Okay, so I want, so the second condition is that any degree 2 cohomology class on X is realized by a divisor, so this should be surjective, even, I mean, up to enlarging K, up to passing to K bar, even without the Galois invariants. Well then, okay, so this, the conjecture on the right, I should say that, I mean, I think there is less evidence for it, but then X is unirational. Okay, and I want to discuss a proof. Okay, recently it has been these two theorems have been proved by various authors for K3 surfaces over, I mean, for K3 surfaces. So assume from now on, so that I don't have to say it again, that the characteristic of K is at least 5 for technical reasons. I mean, in specific places you can change it. Then both results true for k thesis. Okay, so in other words, k thesis is a finite field satisfies the Tate conjecture, and supersingular k thesis is the one that satisfy the assumption on the right, the assumption of the on the rank of Néron-Sévry, are unirational. Okay, so let me explain a little bit, and then I'll go back to the two things. So this two, I'll explain the history of both and who proved this result. I say a lot about this, but the first proofs of these two results, I mean, actually on the right there is only one proof. By now they use heavily, well, the fact that K surfaces have a very nice moduli space, which is, I mean, for general K, I mean, in general K, this is some kind of Shimura variety, essentially, up to an open subset, I guess. And supersingular K surfaces have a very nice moduli space that has been constructed by August, satisfy a Torelli theorem for crystalline cohomology, and so on. So these two results for K surfaces, the first proof, use essentially the structure of this moduli space. You don't prove it by taking one K surfaces and doing whatever and doing some geometry. You prove it by taking all K surfaces in a way at the same time and studying the total family using Torelli, using a lot of results. And so my goal here is to give two proofs, so first of the Tate conjecture and then of a weaker form on the conjecture on the right that works for single K3, that uses the smallest amount of information possible from the fact that K3 surfaces have motifs that are of abelian type, that there is a Kugasaki construction, that there is a Shimura variety laying around. I want to take, on the right, I want to take a single supersingular K3 surface, and I want to find lots of rational curves on it. And what I want to explain is that I think in this result, the train of thought follows the same kind of path as in the complex case. So in the complex case, Shafarevich and Piatetsky Shapiro prove the global Torelli theorem for K3 surfaces. This is a huge accomplishment of classical Hodge theory. And they proved it. The first proof was, I mean, there is a lot of things, but it relies in a specific analysis of Kummer surfaces, of specific examples that we understand very well of K3 surfaces, and so on. And recently, in the complex case again, Verbinski has given a very large framework based on more complex, complex analytic geometry that gives a sort of a general reason for all the Torelli theorem for K3 surfaces that doesn't rely on any specific K3 that we'd have to know. It works in higher dimension, even for families that are...
Can you write down the name of that person?
Oh, I'm sorry. So it's Verbinski. So the result I'm alluding to, so I just want, I mean, it's just a sort of idea of why we would care about giving different proofs of these results. This is a global, I'm talking about the global Torelli.
Just thinking about the Torelli for projective or for complex analytic cases?
I mean, there is a global Torelli for, global, I'm talking about, so Verbinski gave a proof of global Torelli for so-called hyper, for compact hyperkeller manifolds, which has different versions, whether you want to be in the projective case or in the complex analytic case. So he has he first proved it in the complex analytic case, and then this can be specialized to the projective case. Okay, this is a very striking result even for K3, in that you don't have to know any specific K3 to prove it. You just have to know the definition of a K3, but you don't have to use abelian surfaces or anything or any specific result, which was not the case for Piatetsky Shapiro.
This doesn't fit in here into the
No, it does.
But I want to ask. To prove the Torelli theorem for supersingular K3 surfaces as well, can you use the same methods to try to avoid the use of the reductions?
Yes, I'll say something about that at the end. So okay, So I want to give a proof of these results that relies on ideas from complex geometry about the global geometry of hyperkernel manifolds. So of course it's in characteristic P, what we know is in characteristic zero, so there will be some some subtleties, but that's the idea of the talk. So I want to be a little bit broad, and I mean there will be some survey. Okay. So the first thing is the Tate conjecture. So let me write it once more. I mean there are many authors to cite, so I put them after the theorem. So K3 surfaces over finite fields. Okay, here I guess I can say of characteristic at least 3 satisfies the conjecture above. Okay, so the history is of course Tate in the late 60s gave a proof of the Tate conjecture for abelian varieties over finite fields. And then the next, I mean, if you sort of look at the classification of surfaces, the next interesting case and hopeful case is the case of K3 surfaces. And there was some progress that I want to say. So there is maybe 2 results. So there is Tate plus an improvement of Zarin that does the case of abelian varieties. Then there is Artin and Swinnerton and Dyer. Who did elliptic K3 surfaces. And so this is one train of thought that I'll come back to. And on the other hand, this is 69, this is 73, so this is quite fast. And on the other hand, there is another train of thought which starts, I think, with Nygaard. And Nygaard, August, where they prove the case of X of finite height. Then Molik and then myself. This is in 83, I think. This is in 2012. Do a super singular case. And at the same time, Madapusipera, who doesn't just treat, I mean, he just gives a unified proof there is no distinction. So my point, I put 2 columns. So this is purely geometric methods. So you start with, well, either your abelian variety or your K3, and you do a lot of geometry and you get something. And this is, all of these results rely on moduli theoretic method. In a way, all these proofs and starting with the case of finite height is not a result. I mean, you derive a result about K3 by proving result about their moduli space, their deformation space. So the way, for instance, the case of finite height is proved is that you do certain theory for for exists for abelian varieties, it exists also for K3 surfaces. As I mean, first I guess it's in Deligny, Lusy, and Katz maybe, and so you use certain liftings of K3 surfaces to characteristic 0. You use a Kugas-Stake construction, and you use a lot of properties of the deformation space to get this kind of results. And the result of Molik and myself and Madapusipera still rely on a very precise analysis of the moduli space of polarized K3 surfaces or variants. And so I want to explain the left-hand side. So I want to try and give a proof. Okay, so I want to sketch an alternative proof. So here is the thing. So the first thing to notice is that the Tate conjecture is not really a statement about, I mean, when you want to prove it, it's not a statement about constructing divisors. It's a statement about finiteness for certain families of varieties, as is well known. So recall the Kummer exact sequence. So X here is a K3, let's say. More, of course, more general. So you have GM mapping to GM. So let's take this is X maps to X L to the N. And, well, the quotient is, I'm sorry. This has a kernel, which is the sheaf of n sweet of unity, right? And so if you unwind this exact sequence, well, H1 of GM is a Picard group of X. So you get the Picard group of X mod L to the N. Well, that injects into H2 of X mu L to the N. OK, so we get H2 there. And here we get torsion in the Brouwer group. OK. So to prove Tate for X, we only need to show that the L's primary torsion in the Brouwer group of X is finite.
So you also have to pass between cohomology of a K bar and cohomology.
Yes. But I mean, H1 is you. I mean, yes. You have to. But here, so here H1 of the K3 with this coefficient K bar is zero. So I think this is correct as such. So yes. So just to check this, you have to do to be slightly careful. But I think this is correct. Okay. And this is independent of L. Okay. And okay. So the point is that so let me go back to the case of elliptic K3 surfaces. How do Artin and Swinton and Dyer do this? So the example that I want to check is the elliptic case. So I just want to tell you how this works. So assume X is elliptic, i.e. there exists a morphism from X to P1, let's call that pi, with generic fiber, a smooth genus 1 curve. OK, well, then we know, and this is proved in Grothendieck, le groupe de Brouwer, the Brouwer group of X is isomorphic to the Tate-Shafarevich group of the elliptic fibration. Namely, we know that elements in the Brouwer group correspond in a bijective way to torsors under the Jacobian fibration of X. Okay, so X itself is a CD2 Brouwer class of the Jacobian fibration. And from any class in the Brouwer group, we get a different elliptic fibration, which has the same Jacobian fibration, which is the same fibers. And the torsion in the, and if we have a class in the Brouwer group, the torsion in the class is related to the minimal degree of a section, to the index of the generic fiber. Okay, so we know that. And then, okay, So the facts are the following, the geometric facts. And I'll explain how they fit into a slightly larger picture. So first, any torsor under the Jacobian vibration of pi is again a K3. So this is a slightly imprecise statement because, I mean, this is not a group scheme. You have to remove the singular part of the fibers. So the point is that if you restrain to the smooth locus, you take the Jacobian fibration, you take a torsor, then it can be again compactified into a K3 surface. Okay.
You mean, so is it precise? Is it a neuron model or something else?
Yes, I think it is.
Okay, so you claim that any torsor under the neuron model uniquely, in a canonical way, compactifies to a...
Yes, to K3. Okay, so I'll give a more general statement a little bit later. But this is true. And the second thing is the following. Any such torsor, X prime. So take any such torsor X prime. So if you take a Brouwer class that has very, very large order, then this is going to be a very non-trivial torsor. So the index of the general fiber is going to be very big. But it contains, let's say, a divisor D with positive self-intersection, but bounded. So bounded independently of X prime. So you have, on these torsors, you have multi-sections of the elliptic fibration of very, very high degree. But it turns out that the self-intersection, so this intersection has very large intersection with a fiber. But it turns out that the self-intersection of this section is bounded independently of the order of the class. And the last fact, which is due to Sandona, So this is the following thing. The family of pairs X D with X a K3, D a divisor with D square equals D positive. So if I fix this number D, this is bounded.
D is what kind of divisor effective?
I mean, up to changing the sign is going to be effective. A divisor with positive self-intersection is going to be effective unless, I mean, up to a sign. Either D or minus D is effective.
No, speaking about the divisor.
Oh, I'm sorry. I mean, maybe I should put O of D. I don't really care about the specific divisor. So I was talking about the divisor here because I was thinking of a section, but let's put L.
Okay, so this is because L is close to be ample?
Yes, exactly. So of course, if I had put L, I mean, instead of requiring that L square is positive and fixed, I had required that L is ample, then, well, Matsuzaka's big theorem is known in the case of K3 surfaces, And this would be obvious because some power, some fixed power of L is going to be very ample and map X into a fixed projective space with fixed degree and everything. It turns out that for K3-surfaces, and I'll give an intuition, I'll give a reason why, coming from characteristic zero, such divisor is enough to bound the family. It's not ample, I mean, it doesn't have to be ample here, but if you have a divisor like that, you have another ample divisor that has low self-intersection. Okay, so what I claim is that these three facts, they actually generalize to an arbitrary K3 surface. So first, let's notice that these three facts.
So you're saying the family of pairs XL where L
yes.
squared is, but L squared, the D is supposed to be bounded also, not just the.
Yeah, I mean the D, so fix D.
Yeah.
This family is bounded. So it's a. Okay, so these three facts imply finiteness. No. On fix pi, so we are not fixing an ample line bundle, we're fixing this L square, I mean this smaller positivity. So that's the point. So these three facts imply finiteness for the Brauer group of X at, well, let's say the torsion. Well, why is that? Well, if this were infinite, then we would have, well, certainly infinitely many torsors under the Jacobian vibration. So we get infinitely many K3s that way that are pairwise non-isomorphic. That at least give infinitely many isomorphism classes. That's not that hard to check. But they all contain a divisor with positive bounded self-intersection that is independent of the choice of the Brauer class. And then by Saint-Donat's result, they belong to a bounded family. But we are over a finite field, so there are only finitely many K3 surfaces in the parameter space for this bounded family, so we get a contradiction. Okay?
Vous pouvez soulever le tableau parce qu'on ne voit pas. Il y a celui-là. Il y a le nombre.
Okay, so I want to explain, I want to explain why these things generalize.
So that's from the coarse moduli to actual things. So you need to know something about automorphism of such XL.
Well, I'm not really talking about a moduli problem. I'm just saying that there is a scheme of finite type over the base field, whose fibers over K contain all.
No, but to understand the forms of a finite field, you have to understand
yeah.
the analog homology with coefficient in some automorphism.
I mean, you don't even really have to do that. Here's what I mean by this. There is another line bundle here that I can cook up from L. With finitely many choices independently of X, that will give me that will be ample, and give me some fixed power of which will give me an embedding into projective space with bounded.
This is constructed over the finite field.
Yes, you don't have to pass. I mean, if you want to prove this result, you don't have to pass to the geometric. To K bar and then descend. You don't even have to do that. You essentially, if L were ample, you would say, well, maybe L3, I think, is very ample and give me an embedding and then I control the degree and I'm.
Otherwise, you could say that curves of genus 1 is a bounded family, but there are infinitely many.
Yes, no, of course. But this is not what I mean here. So this is a talk where I want to talk about two results. What I want to explain is how you can prove, why these two facts generalize to a K3 that is not elliptic in a suitable way to give finiteness of the Brauer group. So for a general K3. So essentially we need two things. We need a geometric interpretation for classes in the Brauer group. From a class in the Brauer group, we need to construct an auxiliary variety. Here it was a torsor under the Jacobian fibration. We need to do something else. And the second thing is we need suitable criteria for pairs XL. Maybe X is a K3 or something else that will come up from the Brown group. We need a criteria for some kind of boundedness, some kind of bounded families. And even here, it's clear that ampleness is not going to cut it. It's not enough. Okay? So here's what you do. So we can do the same thing. So, well, what do you do with the class in the Brown group? Well, you construct a modular space of twisted sheaves. So that's the key thing. So this is a theory that in this setting has been set up by Leibniz a lot and by other people. I think Martin will talk about related things later. So first step to any class. So in the Brown group. Of X, so any class, let's say alpha n in the L to the nth torsion of X, we can associate a moduli space of sheaves that are twisted by alpha n. So of alpha n twisted sheaves. So I don't want to get too much into what a twisted sheaf.
Invertible sheaves?
Oh, no, I'm not even that. I mean, well, now I didn't say, no, I'm just talking about twisted sheaves. I mean, I can vary the rank.
What you said, the rank of a twisted sheaf?
I'm sorry, what?
A modular space of twisted sheaves of rank something
else? Well, I mean, we can associate lots of moduli spaces by specifying the rank, I mean, the whole chunk character. I'm not... I mean, right now, I of course, I have to fix the numerics of this at some point. Well, maybe so we can associate moduli spaces of alpha and twisted sheaves. So here is the thing. A class in the Brown group corresponds to mu L to the n gerb over X. And twisted sheaves are sheaves on the gerb that are compatible with a mu L to the n action. Another way of saying that is that if you get a twisted sheaf, you can projectivize it, you get a projective bundle or the coherent sheaf version of a projective bundle, and that's what you get. Well, we can see this. And so the fact from deformation theory, this is due, I think, to O'Grady and Yoshioka, so the result in Caltech 6.0, but you can, I mean, it's a deformation theoretic problem that you can that you can get around. Moduli spaces of twisted sheaves on a K3. Okay, for suitable chunk classes. They are smooth, proper, and they are even a little bit more. Their dimension when they are not empty can be as high as you want. It's always even. They are always symplectic, namely, the global section of omega 2 are always generated by a symplectic form, by nowhere, everywhere on the degenerate form, and they are also are simply connected. If we were over C, then this would be what we call a holomorphic symplectic manifold. You know, over a finite field, I don't want to give a definition for holomorphic symplectic manifolds because I don't really know what that is, but we get this. And the point is that torsors under an elliptic vibration are an example of moduli spaces of twisted sheaves. You can write the moduli problem that also satisfies. They are indeed twisted by the same power class, and you can cook it up. And so the fact that any torsor under the Jacobian fibration of pi above is again a K3 surface is just a special case of this very general fact that originates in the work of Mukai, that moduli problems for sheaves on a K3 tend to be unobstructed and give a smooth moduli space. And better, we have good numerics. So here is the numerology that I want to give you. Okay, so define h tilde of x, let's say x k bar zl, to be this way to zl module h2 of x h0 x k bar zl plus h2 x k bar zl of 1 plus h4 x k bar zl of 2. So this is what we call the Mukai lattice. Okay. So I want to look at the algebraic part of the Mukai lattice, and I have a twist. I mean, I have a power class, so everything is twisted. So here's the numerology that I want to give. Let alpha in H2 of x ZL of 1, and alpha n its image in the power group of x. Okay, so we can map this to h2 mu l to the n, and this maps into the l to the n distortion of the power group. Then define the following space. So define the following subspace of this. Define n, so alpha n of x, to be the following thing. So we're going to take the following space: a l to the n d plus a alpha and c omega. Okay. So what does that mean? So a and C are two integers. D is in the Néron-Sévry group of X. Omega, this is the fundamental class. Okay, and this n alpha n of X is a subset of H tilde, right? Okay, well, the first belong to H0, the second thing belongs to H2, and the last thing belongs to H4, right? Okay, so why am I writing that? Well, if F is a twisted alpha n twisted sheaf on X, well, this is a space where its characteristic classes live, okay? So, for instance, the rank of a sheaf twisted by a class of L to the n distortion is going to be divisible by L to the n, for instance. This is the kind of thing. So, the turn classes of a twisted sheaf, if you put them in suitable ways, they live in this space, okay? So, we get a characteristic class V of F in this space. Okay, for instance, the rank is going to be divisible by the torsion of the power group. Okay? Okay, and then what? I'm sorry?
But if you have a twisted shift, then it's a determinant for them to know about C1. The determinant is also...
I'm twisting by the third class also. I'm taking something like the churn character of F times the square root of the third class or something for Riemann Hoch to hold. So it's you have to put the churn classes in the right order for the numerology to work. So anyway, so this is a lot of numerology, but I want to tell you one thing. So fix V now in this group and consider MV, the moduli space of, let's say, stable twisted sheaves of with V of F equals Z. Well, by the result that I just quoted above, this is a nice smooth projective variety. But then, so if okay, so how do I get the numerology of this? H tilde is endowed with a quadratic form, so that we have a quadratic form of an H2, and we added two rank one spaces. I put them as a hyperbolic plane. Okay. So this, I mean, this is just cup product on H tilde, if you want. So if V square equals zero, MV is a K3 with H2 of MV over K bar, coefficient in ZL. This is the orthogonal of V mod V. Mod, well, ZL V. OK? And if V square is positive, then the dimension of MV is 2 plus V square. Well, I mean, this is always true, and H2 of MV, ZL is just the orthogonal of V inside. Yeah, so everything, yes. I wanted to say at some point for suitable V, because I want to be a little bit careful about primitive and rank. I mean, the rank has to be positive and so on. So here is a suitable V. So primitive, the rank has to be, I mean, you have to have a lot of, I mean, some small things so that this is reasonable. Okay, this is the orthogonal of V inside H, inside the Mukai line. Okay, so let's think of it. So let's take an example again. Assume the rank of the Néron-Sévry group of X is at least 2. Okay, so find divisors. Okay, find divisors. Let's say D and E with D square equals minus 2D. So I want this to be negative, and E square equals equals 2E, and the orthogonal. Okay, so the signature on the Néron-Sévry group of X is 1 and rho minus 1. I mean, there is only one positive direction, so I take one positive divisor, one negative divisor that are orthogonal. Okay, assume the Tate conjecture is false, and find alpha, so alpha in the orthogonal of the Néron-Sévry group of X inside H2 XK bar ZL. Yeah, I mean, inside H2 of X, I'm sorry, really So it's a Galois invariant. Okay, and choose L. We can assume that alpha square, so alpha square, I want it to be minus, I guess I want it to be 2D. Okay, so you choose L suitably so that you can fix such a class. Okay? Yeah, L is a prime number, but I allow myself to choose L so that this equation in the orthogonal of the Néron-Sévry group has a solution in the orthogonal in L-adic cohomology.
This you can do by easy, relatively easy.
Yeah, I mean, 2D is going to be a square modulo L for lots of L. Okay, we can assume this, okay, and then take Vn, the following thing. So I look at twisted sheaves, alpha n twisted sheaves with rank L to the n, with Mukai vector, I think, alpha plus d, and then I take 0. Okay, then Vn square, this is 0, this is just because d square is minus 2d. Okay, MVN is a K3. The MVNs are pairwise non-isomorphic. So this is something you can check, for instance, by looking at their Néron-Sévry groups. Okay, this is something that you are able to check. And then the following thing, HN, which is just 0, E0 is orthogonal to Vn, gives a divisor on MVn with square 2e. Okay, so this is I took some time to do that. I'm a little late, but this is exactly, without referring to any elliptic vibrations, this is exactly the Artin-Swinnerton-Dyer situation. We construct a lot of twists of our given K3s that are not isomorphic to each other, and they all have a divisor of positive intersection, which is bounded in terms of the independently of the twist. We get a contradiction by Saint-Donat's result. Okay, because I told you that there are only finitely many K3 surfaces with a divisor of positive bounded fixed self-intersection. Okay, so this is something where you forgot the elliptic vibration, but you need still a little bit of this. So how do you make this work if the Néron-Sévry group of X is not at least 2? Okay, well, you cannot take, I mean, you have to take a Vn, you do the same process, but let me explain, and then I want to talk a little bit about Shioda's conjecture. You want to take Vn with positive square. So let me tell you what happens if we apply the same strategy. What happens for general x? So if we don't know that x has at least two divisors, which should always happen about over finite fields, but we don't know that. Okay, so for general x, same strategy holds. Works.
We don't know it yet, we don't know it at all.
Well, once we prove the Tate conjecture, then we know it, but we are trying to prove it, so I cannot use it right now. So the same strategy works. In the following sense, we get MVN of dimension this time. So if you have to be a little bit careful about the choice of L, about the choice of Mukai vectors, and so on. But you can get a lot of MVNs of moduli like this, let's say of dimension 4. You have to go at least a little bit bigger of dimension 4 with a line bundle of positive. Okay, self-intersection. So this is a little bit tricky, but line bundles on this kind of variety have, it makes sense to talk about the self-intersection and not the top power of John class. This is due to Beauville and Bogomolov. Okay, so here's the last thing. So I want to explain to you why these things, why these objects, they should be bounded.
So what is it? Can you say, tell me what self-intersection?
So the point is that the, so we have what I mean is that if you look at alpha maps to alpha 4 from H2 to Z, or ZL, or something like that, this is the square of a quadratic form. And this quadratic form I call, this is called the Beauville-Bogomolov form, and it is, this is what I mean by self-intersection. In that sense.
It's because there's something special about the way the system is constructed.
So this is something special about holomorphic symplectic varieties over C, but then this is always, I mean, this lives, I mean, this is translates to characteristic P. So I want to, I still like to say a word about the Shioda conjecture at the end. So I just want to, so why are such, so why are such pair, such pairs M, Vn, and a line bundle, let's call it L. So I claim that these pairs live in a bounded family up to birational equivalence. And once you know that, then you are in very good shape to apply the same strategy. If you have infinitely many MVNs, well, I mean, if you have an infinite power group, then you have infinitely many MVNs, but they are all birational to one another, up to finitely many choices, and that's enough to get a contradiction if you work a little bit. Okay, so I want to give you an argument over C, which doesn't work as such in characteristic P, but I think, a good reason to expect this. And this also explains a little bit about Sandona. So first step is a result of Heubrecht, is that L or L dual is big. So it's a little bit like for abelian varieties. For abelian varieties, you have easy criteria to verify that a line bundle is ample. This is a Riemann binary relations. Over these kind of varieties that have a symplectic form, they look like abelian varieties, so we have a numerical criterion to verify that a line bundle, or its dual, have a lot of sections. So this means that the sections of L to the K go like K to the dimension of the variety. So this is a difficult theorem that comes from complex analysis. This is true even in characteristic P because this is invariant under specialization, but I cannot prove it by algebra. I mean, I don't think there is a proof from algebraic geometry. Okay, so this is the first thing. Okay, so now look at the pair M D with L D is a section of L, D effective. Well, this is of general type. In the log category, this is of general type because the canonical bundle is, so this has trivial canonical bundle because it's symplectic, and so the canonical bundle of the log pair is D, which is big. So run the MMP. Okay, so you run the MMP for this pair. What does it do to the canonical bundle? It makes it, well, it remains big, but it makes it nef. You get M prime birational to M plus L prime, which is big enough. So here you have to be, of course, a little bit careful because the MMP creates singularity, so you have to be a little bit careful about what you do with the singularities of the variety that you get. But for symplectic varieties, we can resolve, I mean, Namikawa has shown that singularities of an MMP are taken care of very easily. And then, well, for big enough line bundle, you have results of Collard that give boundedness for L prime, in the sense that, well, it's not ample, but it's as good as ample. Some fixed power of L prime will give you a birational map to a variety of bounded degree in a fixed projective space. Okay, so big enough in that setting is as good as ample. Okay, so I wanted to, well, I'm a little bit late on this, but my takeaway from this was is to explain why this kind of result that you can translate to characteristic P, but this is another. I mean, you have to be careful. I mean, this is not easy, and you cannot translate this strategy to characteristic P at the moment, I guess. Give you some insight as to the geometry of the Tate conjecture. So you can prove the boundedness not by this method over finite field. Okay, so in the 5 minutes that I have, I want to give you one last thing about this, about unirationality of K3. So this is a little bit of the same, in that there are these difficult results from analysis that sort of come up into the way you can think about K3 surfaces. So, recall, so theorem, Lidka, let X be a supersingular K3 surface. Then X is unirational. So I just want to give you a complex result that really looks like this, and I will explain in a word how you can translate it to characteristic P. Okay, so over C, let X be a complex K3, not necessarily projective. Well, then X, well, this is a complex variety, so the C acts on the tangent bundle of X, but it has a quaternionic action. This is a general fact about K3 surfaces over the complex numbers. They are, not only do they have a complex structure, they have a quaternionic structure. This is one way of defining it. So then X has a quaternionic structure. Okay. So what does that mean? So the group of the quaternions acts on the tangent bundle of X. So this means that for any imaginary quaternion, we get a complex structure on X. Okay, you choose a quaternion imaginary of norm 1. Well, its square is minus 1, so this one gives you multiplication by this is complex. You get an almost complex structure on X, which is a complex structure. This is a fact. Okay, so what does that mean? So I'll go back to characteristic P in the 4 minutes that I have. I explain why this works. So consider the following thing. Consider X cross S2. So S2, this is just the unit sphere. So this is identified with a space of quaternions, right? Imaginary quaternions of norm 1, right? And this maps to S2. Well, all the fibers of P are endowed with complex structures . Okay, so you take a point of S2 on the fiber, you put the complex structure given by multiplication by the quaternion parametrized by this S2 . Okay, and again, so complex geometers know this as a twist of space, so S2, this is, well, at least as a manifold, this is the same as P1, as a complex projective line. So, fact, This comes from a morphism from X to, let's say, CP1. I'm really talking about the complex manifold, not the algebraic variety. P, such that this is diffeomorphic to X cross S2. This is the same as S2. Okay, and this is a stereographic projection. Okay, so this is called a twister space. And the salient feature, okay, so we have this, so come with the K3 over C, we have this very specific deformation space parameterized by P1. We have this complete family of complex K3 surfaces. It is not something from algebraic geometry. This is never algebraic. And this is a never, for instance, this large X is never Keller. This is never algebraic. However, let's call this map phi. So the fibers of, okay. I'm sorry, let's consider the absolutely not holomorphic map from X, from curly X to straight X. So this the fibers are S2, right? Are just spheres. So this is not holomorphic. The fibers are still holomorphic curves. The fibers are CP1 with normal bundle. O of 1 plus O of 1. Okay, so the projection, I mean, topologically, this complex manifold is a product. The horizontal lines turn out to be complex curves in that, with normal bundle O of 1 plus O of 1. Well, now, if you are an algebraic geometer, you think, well, this is a very nice situation. I have this threefold. I have rational curves in that with normal bundle, with ample normal bundle. So this should be rationally connected. So this is not the case, right? Because this is not an algebraic manifold, so we don't have any moduli space of rational curves, we don't have any Hilbert scheme at our disposal, so it's not possible in that setting to prove that this twister space is rationally connected, but Campana used it, used this remark to show that X, well, that some fiber, I'm sorry, some fiber of, how did they call it, of P has an entire curve. So that is a holomorphic map from C into the fiber. Okay. Well, what I want to claim is that we can, so in, if I can take 2 minutes, I want to explain that we can do this in characteristic P and we get a rationally connected space, and this is enough to show that supersingular K3 surfaces are, let's say, rationally connected, rationally chain connected, I'm sorry, which is a little bit weaker than Shioda's conjecture. But I want to give a short, I mean, if you use liberally the work of Liebisch, you can do that. Okay, so here is a short proof of this. So this is due to Liebisch, the following is true. So X over K supersingular okay, so X over K is supersingular, then this implies that R2, so maybe let's call that pi is a structure map, R2 pi lower star of mu p in characteristic p, this is representable, so this is the FPPF sheaf. This is representable by a smooth group scheme with connected component GA. Okay? So this is, if you look at the formal Brouwer group of a supersingular K3, this was proved by Artin, I think, that the formal Brouwer group is GA, and then this can be algebraized in a way, in the sense that this is not just a formal GA, this is a whole thing. Okay, so now you play with moduli space of Swiss cheese, as we did before, but now you vary the power class according to GA. So for instance, X always has an elliptic vibration, this can be shown, and you vary, you take torsors under the elliptic vibration that are parametrized by this GA. So you get a moving family of torsors. So get, so this is, I mean, this is by no means trivial, this is really the work of Liebig, who constructs rational curves on the moduli space of supersingular K3, but you get something like this. You get X mapping to A1, like this, a moving family of etal forms of X. Okay, so this A1 is just the GA, but I write it as a family over A1. Okay. Now, it is known by Rudakov-Shafarevich that these, so now we use two things. First, by Rudakov-Shafarevich, supersingular K3 have potentially good reduction. If you work a little bit harder, you use work of Littke and Matsumoto, you can cook up your family X over A1 so that it has good reduction. So you take inseparable covers of A1, and you can get good reduction. So get X bar over P1. But the other thing is well, we get etal forms of our fixed K3, but they are all parametrized by elements of GA. So they are trivialized, if you analyze what this means, they are trivialized by an inseparable cover. So here's what I mean. And then I'm sorry, but I will be done. Plus a degree P, purely inseparable map from some x0, which is a twist of x, cross a1 to, let's say, x over a1. So this family is trivialized after a purely inseparable morphism. And so, okay, so let's look, this is exactly like a twist of space, right? You have a moving family, a complete moving family of K3 surfaces, which are all etal, which turn out to be all etal forms of each other, and up to a, well, to a universal homeomorphism, which is this purely inseparable map, it's covered by, it's the product of a fixed variety and a rational curve. And so what I just want to claim, and I overstayed my time already, is that you can, using this, it's not that hard to prove that the total space here is rationally, let's say, rationally chain connected or has lots of rational curves, and it turns out that the K3 surface you started with by projecting onto it has lots of rational curves. So I don't think you can prove that it's unirational that way, but you can certainly prove that it's uniruled or rationally chain connected. Okay, thank you very much.
Some questions?
You mentioned in the course of the talk, there was something about DNA. You mentioned that if you know the Tate conjecture, you will have that the rank of the Picard group is at least 2.
Yes.
This is over the finite field? Or?
No, over FP bar, over K bar.
And this is just done using the eigenvalues?
Yes, the eigen, I mean, you look at, yeah, exactly. I mean, this is, The rank of the Picard group, I mean, for if you let's assume the Tate conjecture for variety over FP bar, then the rank of the Néron-Sévry group is congruent mod 2 to the second Betti number.
But you also need some semi-simplicity. Ah, no, okay.
No, there's some semi-simplicity.
Well, I'm sorry. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah, but here, I mean, here we know some semi-simplicity.
Is that semi-simplicity is. Okay, three. Is it?
No, it's not known in general, as far as I know.
Ah, but here it follows from.
It's proved by Deligne, I think. I mean, this
is attacking.
Yeah, by Kugel. I mean.
Well, using the Kugel's attacking.
When Deligne proves the veil conjecture for K3, he proves semi-simplicity.
Ah, okay. This was in the 70s.
Yeah, the first the veil. The H2 of a K3 embeds into H2 of an abelian variety, so.
Okay.
in a Frobenius equivariant way.
And what are the possible values for the one severity line?
What are the possible numbers? Well, I think you can get any even number.
So all previous proofs of the Tate conjecture for K3 surfaces in finite characteristic, including your own proofs that was published 2 years ago, used this Kuga-Sake construction using Clifford algebras. So following your talk today, this does not play any role any longer, or does it somehow indirectly?
I mean, okay, so I cheated it a bit in hiding that. So the key thing is that is this boundedness result. So I explained how it is known in characteristic zero, but I mean the proof that I gave. The technology is. Maybe it will never work, but certainly the technology is not there. So there is a trick to sort of use a little bit of Kuga-Sake, but in a very weak way to tackle this boundedness result. So in a way, you apply, you just note that you can apply Kuga-Sake to a non-ample line bundle, and as soon as all this numerology sort of helps you. So it's a very, it still uses Kuga-Sake. It doesn't use Kuga-Sake. So for instance, if you know that you have at least two divisors, that's the first proof that I gave, it works in arbitrary characteristic and doesn't use Kuga-Sake. If you know that you had two, that the Néron-Sévrier group had. Would be of rank at least two. And that's not completely inconceivable that there is some nice trick involving graphs of Frobenius or something like that to prove that it's always the case, but I certainly don't know how to do it.
Yeah. Another question is that in your previous proof, you used some hardcore integral Peale-Koch theory. Where is this?
This aspect sort of disappears. You need just a little bit of periodic. You need Kuga-Sake to say that it varies reasonably or something, but it's much easier technically, I think.
Is it known if the Brouwer group is finite?
Yes, I think it is, because once you know the Tate conjectures, then you know that the Néron-Sévrier group is not too. I think. You have finiteness for the rank of H2. And for the Néron-Sévrier, so the Chern class map has to be.
Because you did only the L primary part.
Yes, but I think once you have the L primary part, I think you can get. You have to use probably a result of Milne as well to get the P primary part. But yeah, I think it is.
You always took P at least 3.
Well, P at least, let's say P at least 5. So the Tate conjecture all works for. P at least 3, so in P equals 2, you really run into problem as long as you want to use Kuga-Sake in any way. So for Picard number at least 2, you don't use it, but if you're outside of that, I don't know how to do it for P equals 2. For the second part, these kind of things, at some point you use Rudakov-Shafarevich, and this uses P at least 5, I think. But so this was the question. I'm a little bit. So one question that I have is, can you use this, instead of using this space and completing to get by Rudakov-Shafarevich, can you use these Twistle lines to prove surjectivity of the period map and to prove Rudakov-Shafarevich, and then to prove Torelli? Because the compactification should have some modular interpretation as well. And so my point is that in the complex case, you prove surjectivity of the period map using these Twistle lines. Can you use these Twistle lines to prove Rudakov-Shafarevich in a sort of hands-free way?
But I think also it is, if I remember well, also in the Matsumoto, there is some hypothesis about the prop.
But it depends. This is not, anyway, Litka-Matsumoto is also something in mixed, it's not exactly this setting. But they use the hypotheses on the prime are of different natures. So for instance, you use to get potential semi-stable reduction or stuff like that. But here you have potential good reduction. You know that by Rudakov-Shafarevich. So you use only parts of that paper.
So let's keep any other questions for the discussion afterwards.